Welcome to Office Mechanics. Coming up on the show, we're going to catch up again today with Mark Russinovich. We'll assess the risks of moving to the cloud. We'll look at the partnership between what Microsoft does to manage the cloud as well as your role in managing your information. And we'll take a look at some real customer examples along the way. Stay tuned. So Mark, welcome back.
Thanks, Jeremy. Thanks for having me.
So we're talking about assumed breach. We're talking about the way that we actually manage the cloud. What's different here? What's new?
One of the things that's new about the cloud is a different perspective on security than traditionally has been in place in IT enterprises. In the enterprise, there was a belief that the perimeter is what you should focus on, creating a strong line of defense against the attackers. And there was little emphasis on dealing with attackers once they got into the network. The fact is, though, as we understand in case after case of public breach tells us, that a determined adversary will get in no matter how strong your perimeter is.
And we've had a lot of cases recently where there have been these types of breaches with, you know, even on-premises customers doing a lot of, to protect their data, in some case, not a lot to protect their data.
Yeah.
But we're going to talk about some of the things that were that are different when you move to the cloud.
Yeah. So this really is about what we call an assumed breach mentality that we have when it comes to our cloud infrastructure, which is we have to assume that attackers will get in. We have to assume that we're going to get breached. And that leads to a different way of looking at it, not just protecting and setting up a strong perimeter, but making sure that when an attacker gets in, that you can detect them as quickly as possible, and then that you got mechanisms in place to isolate them once they're inside, and then to get them out as well.
Right, so all these very important in terms of running the cloud from our perspective as well as your perspective, but even beyond all of that, the cloud itself is a bit of a different attack surface, right? I mean, there are some appealing aspects of trying to attack cloud service providers.
Yeah, so obviously there's free trials, which you can sign up for anonymously in many cases or with a throwaway phone. So attackers get an opportunity to get huge amounts of compute and network bandwidth that they can use for malicious purposes. They also, from a perspective of targets, the cloud makes an attractive target because there's a rich environment there. Many customers up there that are not following security best practices and leaving themselves exposed. There's large IP blocks that the attackers know belong to public clouds, and so that they can go scanning those for those vulnerable targets.
And really, when you think about it, what that means is that from a cloud services perspective, it's really a shared responsibility. On the Microsoft side, you can explain some of the things that we're doing there, and I'll take the admin's perspective in terms of the things that you can do to protect your own environment.
Yeah, so from a shared responsibility perspective, obviously we can't do it all for you. You're configuring your applications and your users in the cloud, and so you've got some responsibility there. Now, when it comes to us and our infrastructure that you're running on, of course, that's our responsibility. And what we're looking at more and more is providing technologies that help you be secure by default, so make it easier for you to do your responsibility by us helping you with security as a service, essentially.
So we do what we can to lock down from an operations perspective the service, make sure everything's secure, the facilities are secure, all of the kind of table stakes of running and managing the service. But when you think about it, as an admin, using things like multi-factor authentication, rolling all your passwords, making sure that you're operating as securely as you can, at the end of the day, you want to make sure that that tenant is secured and locked down and that you're not leaving any vulnerabilities there.
That's right. So standard best practices we see a lot of companies not following, ones that they've been following in their on-prem environment. So they haven't been patching their applications or their operating system. They haven't been setting up network rules to prevent inbound or outbound accesses from to locations that shouldn't be accessible from their applications. We see these kinds of exposures just because people aren't really treating this as part of their infrastructure, which they should be.
We should really dig into some internal stories from the cloud, the things that we're actually seeing as we're operating that, because there are really some internal things that we're doing from a management perspective and some things that we're observing in terms of people using cloud services across Azure as well as Office 365 and other parts of the Microsoft cloud.
Yep, so we'll walk through an example of a real life case of a tenant getting breached in Azure and what we did to help them out. We'll talk about some real world examples of vulnerabilities showing up in software that's being used inside of Azure and by our customers and how we respond to that. Talk about how we protect our infrastructure from malicious insiders or attackers that end up compromising one of our DevOps personnel that wants access to the infrastructure of the cloud. And then finally, we make a huge use of machine learning and data analytics when it comes to detecting security breaches.
That's really cool because we can use the power of the cloud and all the compute to actually run, manage, and secure the cloud. So let's start with tenant breach.
So this is a real-world example of a customer that we detected had VMs exhibiting anomalous activity, huge amounts of egress traffic to locations outside the United States where the application was deployed. We detect this as part of our normal network monitoring. We're monitoring the network traffic on our networks, on our public cloud networks continuously to identify anomalies, bugs in configuration that we might introduce. And then we also pick up examples like this of customer VMs that have been breached and are performing malicious activity. This particular case, we notified the customer that they were breached. They connected to their virtual machines. They had installed antivirus in the virtual machines. They had done the best practice of have those antivirus logs emitted to Azure storage where they were could then be processed and alerts be configured on them. But it turned out that they hadn't been watching those alerts. They hadn't been looking at those logs. So they had no idea that they'd been breached and that their VMs were serving a malicious purpose. When they did go to investigate forensically what was on the VM, their event log showed that 2 days before we notified them that a user account had been added to the admin group on that virtual machine. And this is just a close-up of that event log record of that user being added to that administrator group to give the attacker a place to do their business. So what we did at that point was notify them. They followed best practices. They put in place of having their network traffic go through on their on-premise firewall or appliance. They also had their analytics logs now be processed through their on-premises SIM so that they could get alerts as appropriate in the future. But we see this all the time, customers that are just leaving themselves exposed like this. We, of course, try to do what we can to help them, like we did in this case, but it's part of the shared responsibility here.
Yeah, you have to pay attention to those logs, and we will do what we can. But let's go move on to infrastructure protection, because there's a lot of things that we're doing here, a lot of really famous vulnerabilities. Yep. and viruses, malware that have been in the last couple of months. Why don't you explain that?
Yeah, so of course we pay close attention to when there's a vulnerability in some software that we or customers might be using. Here's three examples from the last year or so: Heartbleed, Shellshock, and an S-channel vulnerability in Windows itself. Our reaction or incident response to these, we treat these as security incidents in terms of going and looking to see if the infrastructure itself is vulnerable in any of these. In the case of Heartbleed and Shellshock, within an hour or less, we determined that our infrastructure was not vulnerable. We were not exposed in any of our software to this. At the same time, we also did scans of our customer VMs to see if they were vulnerable to these, and we did notify them in the case of Heartbleed and Shellshock. In the case of these Linux VMs that were exposed to this, we sent customers notifications that they were exposed. In cases where we saw their machines being used maliciously because attackers were exploiting this, we gave them notice that we were going to shut down their virtual machines within 48 hours unless they corrected the situation, because they were causing a problem for other customers in Azure as well as people in the outside world by having their machines serve up malicious content and perform DDoS attacks on other customers.
Right, so that's one of those things when you're running infrastructure as a service, it's still a lot of times your responsibility to patch those machines because they are just VMs at the end of the day that you are managing the patch state of. We have then the ability on the service side, because we have to do things like meet compliance and regulation requirements. We are patching these things continuously and making sure they're as secure and hardened as they possibly can be. But let's go beyond information protection, because just-in-time and role-based controls are also super important. We've got a picture of the lockbox process. We announced in Office 365 that we actually add customers to this so they can actually approve any required access to information on that temporary basis. And the same thing that we've got on Azure for just-in-time, but this way, a customer in Office 365 will get to be able to vote, yes, you can access my data temporarily to triage what's going on.
That's right. So in this just-in-time access model, which is limited scoped access just to the resources that the developer needs access to troubleshoot a problem, has been something we've had in Azure from the start. A developer, when there's an incident on a piece of infrastructure or a customer VM, there's a ticket that's opened that grants access to that particular resource for a particular user, and that particular or group of users. When that particular group of users goes and requests access, they've got to reference the ticket. The ticket is verified that it grants them access. And then the scoped access is given just to that resource, and it's time-bombed as well. So after a certain amount of time, if the developer's not done, they've got to go request access. And this prevents the case of somebody adding permissions to a resource, forgetting about it, and now you've essentially got a standing admin. Our goal is zero standing admins. Of course, it's really impossible to completely operate that way. There's a few master keys that we have to have just in case of real emergencies, but for the most part, we operate with no standing admin access to the infrastructure.
And the way we like to think about it as well is from an automation standpoint, if we run the service and it's humming along in the right ways, we don't have to have humans actually access the service because all of that is being done through automation. All of the logging is being parsed through health models, all of the big data and cloud controls that we have there. So really it's about not having the zero standing permissions. Things that you might have from an on-premises management perspective, locking those out from the cloud service. But beyond the JIT and RBAC controls, data science, this is where it gets really compelling because we have now machine learning. I mentioned that a little for a brief second there a couple seconds ago. But we can basically take some of the information that we're seeing and detect what's going on in the environment and do a lot of really cool things.
Yeah, so machine learning, like I mentioned, data analytics heavily used in our infrastructure. Obviously for anomaly detection that can help us identify bugs in our infrastructure and our software, but also heavily used for security as well. That just-in-time access process that I mentioned, audited, and then there's data analytics that are looking at that for anomalous patterns in the just-in-time access. So we could detect, for example, a compromised employee that where the attacker is leveraging their access in a way that is abusive and getting them access to the infrastructure and giving us alerts. We've got a philosophy inside of Azure, which is first party equals third party, which means whatever we do and build for ourselves to operate our systems, we believe that customers might find that useful. This is a great example of us taking that same kind of technology, maybe not the exact thing, same thing, but the principle, the philosophy behind it, and making it available to our customers. And this is the case of Azure Active Directory Anomaly Detection Services, which you saw Brad talk about in the keynote on Monday, where we have machine learning analyzing login patterns through Azure Active Directory to detect anomalous situations. Brad talked about the impossible traveler scenario, so somebody's logging in from the United States and 20 minutes later logging in from China, and that's obviously a situation that doesn't make any sense, and the algorithms will send an alert to the administrator so they're aware that they've likely got a compromised credential.
We really want to make sure that these reports and this information is as pervasive as it can be, that you have the transparency for things like these impossible global logins that you couldn't do, you know, within 5 minutes, be in New York and Shanghai at the same time. We'll be able to surface those up inside of Azure in Active Directory as well as inside of Office 365 workloads. So really, really great stuff coming there across the Microsoft Cloud to really bring a lot of transparency to what's going on behind the scenes. So we've covered quite a bit here in terms of all the different things that we can do. Of course, we can't cover everything in our compressed time frame, but when you think about all the things that you can do from a protection perspective, we have controls in place to prevent tenant breach, to prevent any of the infrastructure requirements and the things that you might have to do to patch locally, just-in-time controls, even customer lockbox. RBAC, data science to use the power of the cloud to really secure the cloud. A lot of things that we're doing, a lot of things that we're helping with in terms of making sure you're compliant, making sure systems are patched, and making sure they're as secure as possible.
That's right, and it's an ongoing journey. Like I mentioned, we want to bring more and more of our technologies and systems and approaches and make them available to you. So even when, for that part of the responsibility that's yours, we want to make it as easy as possible. And that data science application to anomalous logons is just one example, a first step in that direction.
And of course, all of this information more, you tweet a lot, you blog a bit. All that can be found on the Office blogs, also on the Azure blogs. This is about all the time we have to talk about all the different things today, but there is a lot more content out there in terms of being able to see what we're doing from Microsoft's perspective and what even Mark's presented in the past. So check all of that out. That's about all the time we have for this show. Thanks for watching and goodbye for now.